organizers, and especially Professor Tala, for inviting me here. I believe he's also maybe even more expert than me in Islamic art. But I'd like to give a sort of a short introduction. I will not be very mathematical nor very physical. I'll try to be more popular. So this is the title of the talk I chose. Once you come to Morocco, of course, you see this Islamic art. Of course, I didn't know that the examples of Islamic art would be so close when I was giving the talk. So here's an example of Islamic art. And another example, very interesting example, is the one here. You see, this is fourfold symmetry, but the artist doing fourfold symmetry, I think, gets bored, okay? So she wants to try something new, and what she puts is a pentagonal star, okay? Of course, this only takes four pentagonal stars because you keep the fourfold symmetry, but then you see there is a pentagon appearing here. When you increase the number of pentagons, etc., then you have this pentagon symmetry, or what is near to quasicrystals. Okay, first, I'm not an expert in crystallography, so I will not talk much about crystallography, but I'll give a few examples. My interest actually was raised in use of five-pole symmetry in Islamic dialects, starting from the 11th to the 13th century. I'm not a historian, but I'd like to be because this is a very interesting subject. Okay, so these are from the websites of an artist, actually. He's an artist and he has websites and he has put this five-fold symmetry, ten-fold symmetry. This is actually a real diffraction pattern, okay? But this artist, also using the computer, generates his own five-fold symmetry, and here are some examples. This is one example. Looks very beautiful and looks like very much like Islamic art. And here is another one, and you'll recognize that this has something to do with panel size. If you're familiar with panel size, you see that road-like blank roads, sort of going. These are called Conway ones. So it's very much in line with Tano's tactics. Now, my collaborator in this work is Mustafa Sancak. He's not a physicist, nor a crystallographer, nor a mathematician. He's, in fact, a civil engineer, okay? But he has lots of insight. So I think maybe he carries some of the genes of these original artists who created this art. We have two articles and a book in Turkish on the subject. Okay, so as an introduction, we know that we can cover the plane with hexagons, squares, or triangles, okay? But we cannot cover it with pentagons because there is a deficiency. But we can approximately cover it with pentagons and two. This is an example of such a tiling. I'm a bit excited because I'm from Istanbul and I just had a message saying that there's a burglar in my house in Istanbul, so I hope everything goes well. Okay, so this is a type of pentagonal tiling. that we had, and the figures here are very nearly the figures that are used in Islamic art. And you recognize that there are two things. One has a sort of a star in the center, and the other has five of what we call tiles in the center of the figure. And if one uses these tiles, one can actually fill the whole space, whole plane using these tiles, and it's called the method of inflation. So you see, starting from a single tile, a single gold tile, you can enlarge it, sort of, by placing other tiles. This is called the method of inflation. So starting from this, you see you again have basically the same figure, but you have just more tiles and the same kind of tiles. So this is the important thing that, was discovered by Penrose, and it answered an important mathematical problem. Okay. So we can work in terms of three basic tiles, which is a tile we call a fish and a star. But actually, you can make a fish and a star in terms of the bow and tile. So we get two basic tiles, the bow and the tile. These are different from the Penrose tiles, but only a little bit different. But they are much more economical for using symmetry and art. And it is actually the Islamic artist who used these two basic figures, the tile and the bow. In their art, okay? So, here are a few examples. This is a famous panel that was found by the historians. It's called the Topkapı Spor panel. And it tells you how to obtain these decagonal pentagonal symmetries. And in these decagonal and pentagonal symmetries, you see we have the decagon can be filled with the bow and the tie, and then you can have you can lose its tenfold symmetry. Okay, so maybe I'll talk about Penrose tiling. Well, maybe not all of you know about the Penrose tiling, but it became popular, and Penrose found three sets of actually tiles. That can cover the plane quasi-periodically. There is no periodic symmetry, but only it's called quasi-periodic. There is local five-fold symmetry. And the historical background of this is Penrose actually solved a very important mathematical problem. Because as we know, there is a tiling, and we say that the tiling repeats itself. Okay, we call this a periodic tiling, just as in the example of a tiling with basically squares or hexagons or triangles. Okay? Now the periodic tiling, after the periodic tiling, the mathematicians, at first they found answers in terms of something like 20,000 tiles. They said the answer is yes, but I have to use 20,000 tiles or something like this and something this. Okay, so then they reduced it to 104. And Penrose reduced it to only two tiles. So he answered this problem. He said, yes, the minimum number of tiles that will cover the plane up to infinity periodically is only two. And this gives rise to quasi-symmetry, local pentagonal symmetry. Okay, so this is the important point. Okay, so here are the three sets of Penrose tiles. The P2 and P3 are equivalent. You can obtain one from the other. But P3, in terms of P3, it's easy to understand the basic things that we call. You see the star, the fish, and the tile. And in all of these, you can have two basic figures. One is the tie, and the other is the one is the sort of the thin rhombus, and the other one is the thick rhombus. Okay, now let us go to history and see how this pentagonal tiling started. As I pointed out here, like here you have, you start with a fourfold symmetry, and then locally you can have fivefold symmetry at places. The earliest example is from the dome of the Friday Mosque in Isfahan. It is from the 11th century. And you see, it's not a tiling actually, but it's just a pattern which has all pentagons making the dome of the mosque. Another more involved example is the sea. This is from Turkey, from the year 1220. Okay. So I asked my collaborator, Mustafa Sancar, can you make a truly terrible styling in terms of these styles, which looks like this? And this is what he came up with. Okay. So this is interesting. You see, this has only local five-fold symmetry, but look at the sides. You don't have the five-fold symmetry, does not continue. Okay, you have local, and it looks very much like these things. So A is a true Penrose styling, whereas B and C are historical examples. Then, of course, you can ask the natural question, are there other historical examples that are closer to a Penrose styling? And then you ask, can the artist who did this, because these artists were actually architects, engineers who knew very good mathematics and geometry, can they have discovered Penrose styles? I don't know. Okay, but certainly they came very close to discovering them. Okay. Now here is an Islamic tiling which uses pentagons and 10-pointed stars. Here are the tiles. You see, we have very many tiles. But what is important is about this is when you look at this thing, here is a decagon at the center. Then locally you have five-fold symmetry. And then you see that at the corners there are one-fourth of a decagon. Once you do this, you see then this side perfectly matches this side, and this side perfectly matches this side. So you can cover the plane. You have changed a pentagonal tiling, a pentagonal symmetry, into a fourfold symmetry, because this is a rectangular tile. So using this rectangular tile, you can cover a wall, for example, okay, periodically. And it is very easy. So this is very remarkable example. It is as if the artists who discovered these tiles knew about perfect pentagonal symmetry filling the plane. But to be practical, in order to be able to make rectangular tiles and cover something with it, okay, they found a way of transforming it into this rectangular tile. Okay, so here are two examples. Of course, most of the examples that we knew are from Turkey. In fact, I'll tell you the story. We thought that this was only found just around Turkey, okay, at first. But as I'll show, it's not the case. So these are the doors of the Süleymaniye Mosque. Think that this is vertical. And you have, again, you see this decagonal symmetry at the center, one quarter of them, and then this sort of pentaplex tiles filling in between. The door has two parts, you know, upper and lower part. The lower part is this, upper part is this. And these are two modern examples that my colleague Mustafa constructed, which look actually, when you first look at it, you think that these are the same, but again, these are truly pentaplex, truly Penrose tiles, whereas these are sort of modified tiles so that you can cover the plane periodically with them. Okay, so here is the basic stuff of what we call inflation. You can have the tile, the fish, and the star, and you can inflate that. These rules of inflation are a bit more complex than Penrose's rules, but this shows that you can make perfectly Penrose tilings in terms of these figures, which you use in historical, which have been used in historical patterns. Okay, so here are four examples. These are filling the square or the rectangle, as you see. There is the decagonal figure at the center with quarters filling the corners, and then other pentaplex tiles, sort of, filling in between. Four important ones. And I would like you to remember A, which is from the year 1250 in Turkey. And we see that these tiles, if you ask who, where discovered these tiles, actually we don't know, because these have been used all over Islamic art. Now this subject became popular just as our book was being published. Lou and Steinhardt published their famous article in Science, and they said the words, "We show that by 1200 a conceptual breakthrough occurred in which Greek patterns were reconceived as tessellations of a special set of equilateral polygons, Greek tiles decorated with lines. These tiles enabled the creation of increasingly complex periodic Greek patterns, and by 15th century, tessellation approach was combined with self-similar transformations." That's what we call an inflation, okay? To construct nearly perfect quasi-crystalline Penrose patterns. This is 5 centuries before the discovery in the West. Now I would like to say a few words about this Lou and Steinhardt work. And here is one of their examples. Their primary example is from Darbe Imam in Isfahan in 1453. And you see, when you look at this figure, you immediately see these decagonal, white decagonal figures. But another figure that you see is that these black lines, and remember this was done in 1453, okay? But if we go back, I'm afraid to go back. If you go back, remember that the example from Anatolia in Turkey of this example from 1250. So there are 200 years in between, but it looks like the same figure is being used over and over. We also know that in those times, these artists who became famous actually traveled in Islamic lands, okay? So they traveled in Islamic lands, and so this is a very important example. It takes a basic figure used in 1250, and then it uses this inflation sort of thing to fill in between, to get almost a Penrose tile. Now the question is this, can this be a real Penrose tile? So I asked this question, we asked this question, and my collaborator, who is really good at these things, he came up with an answer, okay? So he built an exactly Penrose tiling, which is shown in A, okay? So this is an aperiodic pentaplex tiling, which you can enlarge to cover the whole plane aperiodically. The borders are taken such that they fit the borders from Darbe Imam in Isfahan. And then this is the pattern in Isfahan. And then we ask the questions. What are the imperfections? Well, they are not imperfections, maybe in the artist's sense, but from the physicist's sense, you can ask the question, what are the imperfections in this that do not match the Penrose tile? And you see that there are some decagons here that don't match. Okay? Some decagons don't match. But it is interesting that for most of the decagons, for example, take the decagon here and the same non-matching decagon here, what is the difference? You see that they are the same decagon, but one is rotating with respect to the other. So this raises a very interesting question. We in fact investigated and found that this had several major repairs during the history. Okay? So originally one can not keep wondering if originally it was a truly pentaplex panel styling figure, and then when it was damaged, it was repaired, and the repairing person was not as good as the person who built this, and so he said, well, here is it, it matches it. We don't know, of course, but this is a very interesting. Okay, so here is the example of this, how the Isfahan tiles can be obtained. Remember that there we had the decagons placed and quarter of decagons placed in the center, and this is a perfect example of how you can do this inflation. Now, even if the artists who built these things didn't know about panel styling, didn't know about the question how you cover a plane aperiodically with something, etc. They knew certainly about this inflation, because inflation covers this golden ratio tau. Okay? And what is the golden ratio tau? The golden ratio tau is that if you draw a pentagon, you can draw isosceles triangles in the pentagon. And the isosceles triangles, you see there is a thin one and then there is a thick one. They have the side ratios, small sides A and big sides B, shown in blue. And the ratio of these two things are give you the golden ratio. This is actually a much sort of better or easier definition than the usual definition of the golden ratio in terms of a square and a rectangle, such that when you take a square out of a rectangle, you are left with a similar rectangle. It solves the same problem. But for pentaplex styling, this is actually what is the most important question. Okay, now I'd like to continue showing some of the things that were created by my collaborator, and these are all truly pentaplex stylings, but very much look like art. Okay, so here is one. Okay, and when you look at it, you see this is interesting. It looks as if, well, sort of you have a row here, another row here, but this doesn't go forever. Okay, so it looks like it has some fourfold symmetry, but it doesn't. It actually only has a pentaplex sort of quasi-symmetry. Okay, so here's another example. This is in terms of the two basic tiles, the bow and the tile. And this is again a perfect parallel styling. Okay, so here's another one using the stars. Now this is a very interesting pattern, because when you look at these quasicrystal patterns or pentagonal symmetry patterns on the doors, you see that there's another technique involving the borders. Okay, so here are the borders. These are the borders. Okay, and the borders are actually lines. And you see that when two lines meet, one line goes from under the other one. And the rule is that the lines go always above, under, in that order. Okay. the artists who had built these had adorned their figures with these lines. I'm not aware of any mathematical theory of giving the rules of these lines. So we were interested, okay, and tried to look at these lines. So here's another one. You see here, you see a lot of closed borders like this, and again this rule going from under and above. And what you do is you do a perfect Penrose tiling using any set of tiles, and then try to put these in, and it turns out that you can put these in, these borders in, and the borders have this interesting behavior. So here's another one, and here's another one, and this is a, this is of course does not have borders, but it's a very modern looking thing, but it's again a perfect Penrose tile. Okay, so this is another one. This is a secret. This is not exactly Penrose tiling, but obtained from Penrose tilings. It's obtained by superposing two Penrose tilings, and I think it looks very beautiful. Okay, and here is part of it. And here is the investigation of the technique of these borders going above or below each other, and in any kind of tiling, you have these borders forming shapes, and you have several shapes, and it's mysterious. I mean, we couldn't discover the mathematical rules behind that. Here's another one where you have these five types of borders. And now I would like to give a few more examples which we call modified pentaplex tiling. What's a modified pentaplex tiling? Think of it in terms of a crystal. Suppose inside the crystal I have something that makes it the shaping perfect, but you can remove that piece and replace it with a similar piece, okay? Which will be sort of an imperfection in the crystal, but art-wise, in terms of tilings, it can look better. So what do? We take a true Penrose tiling in terms of some set of tiles, okay? And then from in these tiles, we see that there are decagonal ridges. We enter the decagonal ridges and put a perfectly symmetric decagon into this thing. Okay, and this gives something that looks more like art, and one sees that this technique was also used in Islamic tilings. So these are all examples of these decagons being replaced by more symmetrical figures. You can put more of them, okay, or less of them, and then here's another example of replacing decagons, okay? So here we start with a perfectly Penrose tiling, okay? And then replace, of course, the decagons with white spots until we obtain a more symmetrical looking thing, which is no longer a Penrose tiling, and this we call a modified Penrose tiling.